News Alert. Good evening. Welcome to Washington. I'm Bret Baier. Tonight, Democrats are trying to minimize the self-inflicted damage from comments viewed as anti-Semitic by one of their high-profile freshman lawmakers. We're also at this hour awaiting the sentencing of former Trump campaign chairman Paul Manafort. First, the Democrats and anti-Semitism. What was once thought to be an easy fix, a public resolution, has turned into a political football. And Republicans, and even some Democrats, are saying the Democrat leadership in the House is fumbling that football. Chief Congressional Correspondent Mike Emanuel starts us off tonight from Capitol Hill with a vote that just wrapped up. Good evening, Mike.
Brett, good evening to you. The vote was 407-23 with Iowa's Steve King voting present. But this has been an epic struggle all week. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi forced to defend one of her controversial and high-profile freshman members.
It's up to her to explain, but I do not believe that she understood the full weight of the words.
A reference to Minnesota Democrat Congresswoman Ilhan Omar, who suggested those who support Israel have dual loyalty, and that being opposed to Prime Minister Netanyahu and, quote, the occupation is not the same as being anti-Semitic. The anti-Semitic resolution noted that the House of Representatives condemns anti-Semitic acts and statements as hateful expressions of intolerance that are contradictory to the values that define the people of the United States. But after an internal battle among Democrats, the name of the resolution was changed to anti-hate and was broadened to include a wide range of bigotry victims. Jews, Muslims, Hindus, Sikhs, the LGBTQ community, immigrants, and others with verbal attacks, incitement, and violence.
We're sadly living in a time in this country where we're seeing a rise in anti-Semitism, a rise in Islamophobia, a rise in racism and bigotry.
Rallying to Omar's defense, some of her fellow high-profile freshmen. New York Democrat Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez has been tweeting her defense of Omar to nearly 3.5 million followers. There seems to be no problem at all with a zero-tolerance stance for simply asking about U.S. foreign policy. And Michigan Democrat Rashida Tlaib went even further.
I can tell you, when she speaks about those issues, what I hear is her trying to uplift my grandmother in Palestine, in the West Bank, and saying that there are real, actual, factual evidence to show that there's human rights violations.
Republicans sounded stunned by the civil war on the other side of the aisle.
There's a fracture, obviously, in the Democrat Party. There's a radical leftist fringe that's really intolerant, particularly towards our Jewish friends.
And now some Democrats are upset leadership caved.
And when one of our colleagues invokes the classic anti-Semitic tropes, the anti-Semitic language, that Jews control the world, that Jews care only about money, that Jews cannot be loyal Americans if they also support Israel, this too must be condemned.
Republicans say the shift to the left is shocking.
This is not your father's Democratic Party. If it was ever more obvious than today, I don't know when it was more obvious. They can't agree to condemn anti-Semitism.
Some sources suggest this signals possible trouble for Speaker Pelosi and her leadership team over the next 2 years when you consider this non-binding resolution was really quite a struggle this week. Brett?
Mike Emanuel, live on the Hill. Mike, thanks. There is precedent for anti-Semitism ravaging a political party. Tonight, senior foreign affairs correspondent Greg Palcott takes us to Great Britain, where such a scenario is playing out right now.
As the Democrats in Congress deal with issues of anti-Semitism, the UK is confronting an even bigger firestorm involving the center-left Labour Party. Labour admitting in the past year there have been nearly 700 complaints of anti-Semitism by its members, including online attacks, offensive social media groups, and verbal harassment. Anti-Jewish behavior, a reason given by most of the 8 parliament members who quit Labour recently.
I cannot remain in a party that I have today come to the sickening conclusion is institutionally anti-Semitic.
For many, hard-left Labour Party leader Jeremy Corbyn is in part to blame for the anti-Semitic problems. A longtime critic of Israeli policies and a defender of Palestinian causes, some say he has veered into anti-Jewish actions, including being too lenient about misdeeds of party members.
The row over anti-Semitism has caused immense hurt and anxiety in the Jewish community.
For Conservative Prime Minister Theresa May, whose party is racked by its own divisions due to Britain's impending exit from the European Union, Labour's political woes have been seized upon.
I never thought I would see the day when Jewish people in this country were concerned about their future in this country.
In fact, Labor has recently expelled 12 members and suspended another 96. Studies have been launched and codes of ethics applied. Still, with anti-Semitic acts reaching a record high in the UK last year, experts say talk sets a tone.
We have seen anti-Semitism rise in the Labour Party, and we've seen anti-Semitic crime rising. I don't think that it is a total coincidence that that is happening.
Experts we spoke with said the situation in the U.S. is different, but the message is the same. Political parties should handle this issue with care. If there's anti-Semitism, they say, it should be stamped out. Brett.
Greg, thank you. Again, we're awaiting the Paul Manafort sentencing any moment now. We'll bring that to you live. Meantime, we're learning new information tonight about whether former Trump attorney and fixer Michael Cohen did in fact seek a presidential pardon. He's testified, as you know, before Congress that he did not. Now his lawyer is painting a different picture. Here's Chief Intelligence Correspondent Catherine Herridge.
Mr. President, any talk of pardons between your representatives, your lawyers, and Michael Cohen's legal team?
President Trump brushed off questions about his former personal attorney who faces new allegations that he may have perjured himself again before Congress.
I have never asked for, nor would I accept, a pardon from President Trump.
Cohen's lawyer, Lanny Davis, who sat through the 7 hours of testimony, issued a clarifying statement that, in fact, before July 2018, quote, Cohen directed his attorney to explore possibilities of a pardon, at one point with Trump lawyer Rudy Giuliani, as well as other lawyers advising President Trump. On Twitter, Giuliani called out the apparent inconsistencies, writing, never means never ever, not after July 2018, which is the latest deception, another perjury, and more prison. This testimony is also under review.
Mr. Trump's personal lawyers reviewed and edited my statement to Congress about the timing of the Moscow Tower negotiations before I gave it.
On Wednesday, Cohen provided House investigators with records that include edits by the president's legal team. Two sources report that the original date in the Cohen draft was January 2016, undercutting allegations that the president's lawyers made edits that altered the timeline. The special counsel prosecuted Cohen for lying to Congress about the timing because talks continued as Mr. Trump campaigned for the presidency. Contact between Cohen and staff for Adam Schiff, the Democratic chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, is also under scrutiny. Two sources tell Fox there were at least four meetings in New York, totaling more than 10 hours. In this letter to Cohen, House Republican Mike Turner said the public has a right to know whether, quote, they were watching witness testimony or well-rehearsed theater.
Those close to Cohen believe he will be vindicated and want the transcript from this week's private testimony released. Cohen also filed a civil suit today alleging the Trump Organization failed to cover his legal fees and costs that arose from the ongoing investigations. A lawyer for the president disputes the claim. Brett.
Catherine, thank you. Wall Street's losing streak extends to four tonight. The Dow lost 200. The S&P 500 dropped 22.5. The Nasdaq fell 84 today. There are questions tonight about whether the president is losing ground on some of his top priorities: the economy, trade, immigration, and even North Korea. Chief White House correspondent John Roberts takes a look.
In the Oval Office with the Czech Prime Minister today, President Trump seemed to indicate he didn't expect any significant developments on North Korea for the foreseeable future. At this point, no one seems to know which way this is going to go. Based on negotiations leading up to the summit, Kim Jong-un was expecting President Trump to cut a more lenient deal and was surprised when he walked away.
Well, I think the North Koreans obviously would like to give up as little of their nuclear, biological, and chemical weapons and ballistic missile programs as they could in exchange for very broad sanctions relief, and that's basically what they asked for. The president wasn't buying it.
The president's critics applaud him for walking away from a bad deal, but also say he hasn't gotten any farther with North Korea than his predecessors. President Trump's allies disagree, saying he has changed the game.
He's put the country in a position of where we're finally talking to North Korea. Whether or not we get a deal, I don't know, but everybody before Trump pretty much failed, and this is the most hopeful I've been, but we'll see what happens.
What happened in Hanoi didn't go unnoticed by the Chinese. In the Oval Office today, the president said trade talks are going well with China, but Fox News has learned Chinese officials are concerned President Trump may bring Xi Jinping all the way to Mar-a-Lago later this month, only to walk away from him. At the same time, there is new uncertainty over a China trade deal. Critics insist the president is losing the battle over immigration, facing an all but certain rebuke from Congress over his emergency declaration.
When it comes to immigration, by every measure, the president's approach has been a failure. I think the president is now facing a confrontation with Congress over executive power that can really undermine the relationship between the executive and legislative branches.
But even as the votes are being counted, an explosion of illegal immigration. 76,000 people were apprehended at the southern border last month. DHS saying the U.S. is on track to see 1 million illegal immigrants this year.
It is a crisis. It is an emergency. And Democrats have their heads so far in the sand when they say this is manufactured. This is a real crisis. It's beyond anything we've seen in the past.
And Democrats are also hammering the president on his signature issue, the economy, pointing to General Motors' decision to shut down a big plant in Lordstown, Ohio. Democrats saying the president promised to bring jobs back to Ohio and gave millions of dollars in tax credits to General Motors, only to watch GM cut thousands of jobs. Brett?
Hey John, we're awaiting the Paul Manafort sentencing. It's still going on at this hour. Do you expect anything from the White House after this comes down?
I don't know for sure. I have reached out to Rudy Giuliani and Jay Sekulow, the president's outside counsel, for any reaction that might come in the wake of that. There's always the possibility the president might tweet. We should point out that the president believes that Paul Manafort has been very, very harshly treated by the special counsel's office, kept in isolation in prison, only allowed out a couple of times a day, and then brought in so many times to the special counsel's office to be interrogated by investigators. So I wouldn't be surprised if we saw some sort of a tweet by the president, but I don't know for sure. Brett?
Okay, John, thank you. Just getting word that Paul Manafort did speak in court. We don't have the what exactly he said to the judge, but there is a brief recess right now, so the cliffhanger continues on the sentencing here. Up next, Bernie Sanders heads to Iowa for the first time in this season's presidential campaign. We'll go live there and bring you that sentencing as well. First, here's what some of our Fox affiliates around the country are covering tonight. WDRB in Louisville, as at least four Kentucky school districts cancel classes because of too many teacher absences, as educators there continue to protest at the state capitol. Teachers are upset about several bills in the state legislature, including one that would provide scholarship tax credits for private schools and another that would change who manages the pension fund for teachers. Fox 32 in Chicago, as authorities say a sheriff's deputy has died after a shooting at a northern Illinois hotel. The McHenry County Sheriff's Department identifies the man as 35-year-old Jacob Keltner. Officials say Floyd Brown opened fire when officers tried to serve a warrant. They say he crashed his car along an interstate highway as he tried to flee. At last word, around the Rockford area, he remains barricaded inside the vehicle. And this is a live look at Miami from our affiliate, WSVN, at Sunset in Miami. The big story there tonight, a fired Florida police officer is found guilty of manslaughter and attempted murder for fatally shooting a stranded black motorist. Newman Raja faces a mandatory minimum sentence of 25 years. He could spend his life in prison for the death of 31-year-old Corey Jones. Raja is the first officer in the state to be convicted of an on-duty shooting in 30 years. That's tonight's live look outside the Beltway from Special Report. We'll be right back. There, he was in a wheelchair, said the last 2 years have been the most difficult for his family and that he's ever experienced. And to say, quote, that I am humiliated and ashamed would be a gross understatement. Right now, the court is in another recess. We expect the sentencing to come down any minute. When it does, you'll see it here on Fox. Meantime, 2020, the man who is currently the front runner among declared Democratic presidential candidates takes his campaign to the crucial state of Iowa tonight for the first time since committing to a second run. Senator Bernie Sanders begins a 3-day tour of the first caucus state with a rally in about an hour and a half. He does so as the man who figures to be his top competition looks more and more like he's getting in. Correspondent Peter Ducey is in Council Bluffs, Iowa tonight. Good evening, Peter.
Good evening, Brett. For the first time this cycle, a Democratic candidate visiting Iowa needs a room bigger than something the size of a high school gym or a coffee shop. Bernie Sanders rented out a convention center, and he is starting to fill it with longtime supporters who came from all over the Midwest and who are not all Democratic socialists.
Sanders kind of got me into the process, and I'm kind of wanting to see if the message is still the same.
His ideas, the way he leads his campaign, I am still doing research on pretty much every candidate out there, too. So this will just help me gain more information about him.
While I'm probably not as far left as he is, I enjoy hearing different kinds of perspectives, and so I thought I'd come here today.
If primary voters sour on a Democratic socialist, they might soon have a more moderate choice, Joe Biden. The New York Times reports Biden advisors are likely to set up a campaign headquarters in either Wilmington or Philadelphia, and that his strategist is calling around to tell Democrats the former VP is 95% in. The 5% hesitation is believed to be about the possibility that the personal lives of Biden's family members might wind up on front pages again.
Primary will be very difficult, and the general election running against President Trump, I don't think that he's likely to stop at anything.
Sherrod Brown is going to try to stop Trump as well, just not as a candidate for president. Brown said today, I will keep calling out Donald Trump and his phony populism. I will keep fighting for all workers across the country, and I will do everything I can to elect a Democratic president and a Democratic Senate in 2020. The best place for me to make that fight is in the United States Senate. Right now, the Real Clear Politics average of polls finds that Biden has almost 30% of Democratic primary support, and Bernie has almost 20%. So they combine for half of all the votes out there in a historically diverse field with more Democratic women running than ever before. Remember this New York Times headline from October, quote, in 2020, Democrats expect a female frontrunner or three, but the clear frontrunners for now are two white men in their late 70s. Brett?
Peter Ducey in Iowa at the Senator Sanders event. Peter, thanks. We told you last night the Democrat Party has denied Fox News' request to host one of the Democratic presidential debates this summer. 3 years ago tonight, in the last election cycle, we hosted a town hall in Michigan featuring Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders.
I have helped lead the opposition against every one of these terrible trade programs. NAFTA and permanent normal trade relations with China. I don't believe American workers should be forced to compete against desperate people around the world who are making pennies an hour.
I've heard others say that neither you nor your lawyers have been apprised that you are a target of the investigation. Is that true?
Absolutely true.
Have you or your lawyers been apprised that any members of your current or former staff are targets of the investigation?
Absolutely not.
At the time, you and your staff deleted nearly 32,000 emails.
Let me clarify this. I have said it wasn't the best choice.
Sanders went on to win the Michigan primary a few days later. Fox News has asked Democratic Party officials to reconsider their decision about this year's debates. One of the men who still might become a declared candidate says he may be the moderate voice America needs right now. Tonight, correspondent Jillian Turner talks with former Starbucks CEO and possible independent candidate Howard Schultz.
If the Democrats decide in their wisdom to nominate a far-left person who is professing policies that resemble that of a socialist, that will be the spoiler.
Presidential hopeful Howard Schultz is punching back today against the Democratic establishment. They've been blasting his flirtation with an independent run, calling him a spoiler to winning the White House in 2020.
An organized effort by a group of people that are trying to do whatever they can to stop me.
The former CEO of Starbucks takes care to describe himself as a centrist independent, but an independent of any stripe has never won the presidency. And it's far from clear that Americans dissatisfied with President Trump would jump ship and vote for another billionaire businessman.
Running Starbucks is not necessarily a proxy for being the president of the United States. But what it does demonstrate is a level of leadership.
President Trump's leadership, according to Schultz, has been a dismal failure. He calls the recent North Korea summit a sham and the troop withdrawal from Syria and Afghanistan a disaster.
And I think we're going to suffer a great deal by having Russia in control in the Middle East today.
He's unafraid to make unpopular decisions, he says, like sending Americans back to war if necessary, or confronting ugly, divisive issues.
There's a 61% increase in anti-Semitic activities in the United States today. As a Jewish person, I find that horrifying.
Here in San Antonio, where Schultz is in the middle of a five-day-long swing through Texas, he says he welcomes Joe Biden's potential entry into the presidential race. Schultz is moving forward with hiring seasoned political operatives for his team from both sides of the political aisle. He says his final decision, though, will come this summer. Brett?
Jillian, thank you. Up next, the epidemic of substandard housing for America's heroes and their families. First, beyond our borders tonight, a court in France finds a French cardinal guilty of failing to report to authorities allegations of sexual abuse by a priest. Cardinal Philippe Barbaron was given a 6-month suspended prison sentence. 5 other defendants were acquitted. Chinese tech giant Huawei is challenging a U.S. law that would limit its American sales of telecom equipment. This year's U.S. Military Appropriations Act bars the government and its contractors from using the company's materials over security concerns. And in Geneva, this is the most expensive new car ever sold. It's one of a kind, Bugatti luxury sports car. The price? $18.9 million. The manufacturer unveiled it at the Geneva Auto Show this week. The identity of the buyer has not yet been revealed. Just some of the other stories beyond our borders tonight. Again, awaiting that Paul Manafort sentencing. Should be in a minute. We'll be right back. This is a Fox News alert. A federal judge has ruled the Trump administration can enforce restrictions on transgender people in the U.S. military. The judge lifting an injunction a short time ago regarding a case in Maryland. The U.S. Supreme Court had already made a similar decision over cases filed in 2 other states. The Pentagon and officials there say it will keep the current policy in place, allowing transgender people to serve until further guidance is issued. Speaking of the military, many of our nation's finest are living in homes that are among the worst you can imagine. That is the subject of a lot of congressional soul searching tonight and many hearings. National Security Correspondent Jennifer Griffin has the story from the Pentagon. Good evening, Jennifer.
Good evening, Brett. Soul searching on every level here at the Pentagon. This scandal finally has the attention of Congress and the top military brass.
I listened in horror as families at Camp Pendleton told of mice eating through pacifiers in their babies' cribs and electrical outlets catching fire due to wiring issues.
Deplorable conditions such as toxic mold, lead, and rodents inside base housing from Camp Lejeune to Fort Belvoir, Fort Meade, and beyond. Angry senators demanded answers from the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines.
I want to start by first apologizing personally on behalf of the Department of the Navy to any sailor, Marine, soldier, airman, Coast Guardman that was affected.
I think we took our eye off the ball, and we've been a little busy the last 17 years.
So I want all of the soldiers out there to know that their chain of command is now fully engaged.
The conditions inside the homes remain secret in part because the private landlords contracted by the military demanded some families sign non-disclosure agreements.
I can't imagine on any level why it would make sense to have a new tenant, these young kids, asked to sign this agreement, not understand the implications of it. So in my view, if any of these agreements are in force, I expect them to be rescinded over the next 30 days.
A Navy family had squirrels enter their attic through a hole in the roof. Soon after, the squirrels died and maggots dropped through their ceiling fan onto their bed.
It came out during the hearing that one property management team visited that same home 52 times and never got to the root of the problem. The military service chiefs are proposing a tenant bill of rights for all military families, Brett.
Jennifer Griffin, live at the Pentagon. Jennifer, thank you. President Trump's point man for the Venezuela crisis says the Trump administration has no plans for military intervention there. But there are plans to ratchet up the economic and political pressure on disputed President Nicolas Maduro. And some Venezuelan refugees may be allowed to stay in the U.S. State Department correspondent Rich Edson begins his report tonight with the latest on an American journalist detained in Venezuela.
American journalist Corey Weddle is finally home, hours after Venezuelan security forces appeared at his apartment.
So I was there detained for pretty much the entire day with my face covered with a ski mask with the counterintelligence folks there. So it's been a stressful few days.
Venezuela then deported him after covering what Weddle described as opposition leader Juan Guaido's triumphant return to Caracas. Millions have fled poverty, starvation, and medicine shortages in Venezuela. A fact driven home by Florida Senator Marco Rubio today at a hearing on Capitol Hill.
3.4 million Venezuelans have fled Venezuela. If we said 10% of the U.S. population had left over 5 years, it would be the equivalent of every person living in Florida, Maryland, and Massachusetts.
The State Department Special Envoy, Elliot Abrams, testified the Trump administration is considering allowing Venezuelans in the United States to stay here during the crisis.
We have this policy actually under review right now. I would say that there are 74,000 asylum applications right now from Venezuela.
What is there to review? We all have pointed out the urgency of this situation. This is not a matter that can wait. So I'm somewhat puzzled as to what there is to review.
Abrams also testified the United States is preparing its next round of sanctions to isolate Maduro, targeting foreign banks working with the regime.
We have sanctioned a number of financial institutions already, and we're going to expand the net.
Though disputed, President Nicolas Maduro remains with the support of Venezuela's military leadership, along with help from Russia, China, and Cuba, and a crackdown on journalists and dissent. Brett?
Rich Edson at the State Department. Rich, thanks. We're still awaiting the Paul Manafort decision, the sentence. Meantime, House Democrats struggle with an anti-Semitism resolution. We'll get reaction from the panel.
I feel confident that her words were not based on any anti-Semitic attitude. I do not believe that she understood the full weight of the words.
I am here with my friend from New York debating a resolution that all of us should have learned in kindergarten. Be nice. Don't hate.
I know that Congresswoman Ilhan Omar really tries to push back against oppression. And as a Palestinian, I can tell you that there are real factual evidence to show that there's human rights violations.
Make no mistake, our caucus is unified, but unity does not mean unanimity.
Well, it's an anti-hate resolution, it turned out to be. It started out as anti-Semitic based on the comments of Congresswoman Omar from Minnesota. The House voting on this resolution overwhelmingly, 407-23, but basically condemns all anti-Semitic, anti-Muslim discrimination, bigotry against all minorities, contrary to the values of the U.S. In the meantime, many Democrats kind of tripped over themselves on talking about this resolution. We just saw there Congressman Clyburn. Told The Hill, there are people who tell me, well, my parents are Holocaust survivors. My parents did this. Well, it's more personal with her, Congresswoman Omar. I've talked to her. I can tell you she is living through a lot of pain. Talking about her time in Somalia. It has been an interesting week for Democrats on this issue. Let's bring in our panel. Tom Rogan, commentary writer for the Washington Examiner. Molly Hemingway, senior editor at The Federalist. And Mo Alethi, executive director of the Georgetown Institute of Politics. Mo, your thoughts about how this was handled and the end result here that critics say was pretty watered down.
Yeah. I join those who criticize the Congresswoman for her comments. I think it is possible to criticize Israel and its policies as a nation without using language that is offensive to many people and is seen as anti-Semitic. At the end of the day, I actually wish that that the resolution had called her out by name. Having said that, at the end of the day, you had a resolution that condemned all forms of hate. And in this case, not only did she say some things that were viewed as anti-Semitic, but in response, she received a lot of hate. There was there were posters in West Virginia being disseminated in the state capitol that connected her to 9/11 terrorists. So to be able to take a strong stand against all forms of hate, I think is a good thing. And I think the Republicans who've been looking to make hay out of this have set a trap for themselves, because every single no vote, 24 members of the House voted no, they were all Republicans who now are on record against a resolution condemning all hate.
Even though this didn't point out the original offense
or specifics.
It didn't point out the original offense, and I think it should have. But at the end of the day, when you've got a chance, and there were a lot of Democrats who wanted this to be stronger, but didn't vote no. They still voted yes because they wanted to take a strong stand against hate.
So you're saying the political issue.
Yeah,
Molly.
I think that's very unfair. I mean, obviously, people were hoping that there would be an actual resolution condemning the anti-Semitism of one of the members of Congress, and that didn't happen. And I think that's what people were frustrated by. But I do agree, you know, this has been such a disaster for Democrats that I think Republicans are kind of saying, well, gosh, it's really bad over there. But in fact, the rise of anti-Semitism is not something anybody should be thinking about what's good politically out of it, because it is a very bad thing. You're seeing the rise of anti-Semitism in the Democratic Party right now, but it's a problem that's happening globally. And we have particular concern about this because of our recent history where people took that sin of anti-Semitism and used it to commit a genocide of 6 million Jews. That's in our recent history, or 6 million people, including millions of Jews. And that's in our recent history, and it's something that there's a reason why people are sensitive, particularly around this topic. And it's not just about having a difference of policy about what to do with regard to Israel. I think the reason why people were so frustrated by the comments that they heard, or so sickened by the comments they heard, were that these were actually comments against Jews and using some of the most vicious anti-Semitic tropes against
Jews. You know,
mentioned
the world situation in the UK, and we did a piece on this. It's a real issue now. Take a listen.
When I joined the Labour Party, I thought I was joining a broad church, and it's now clear that that broad church, which brought many of us into the Labour Party, no longer exists.
It's not just the politics, it is whether you can feel a moral integrity to go along with things that you can no longer justify or accept.
So, Tom, I mean, it's real. It's not just here and the politics of here and what Omar said and what the Republicans did. I mean, it's in Great Britain they're dealing with it.
It's very substantive, and we see the hate crime incidents, violent criminality is attached to it. But I do think the binding factor here, Jeremy Corbyn, I think, outside of observers would say, has more personal issues in terms of inklings towards anti-Semitism than, say, Nancy Pelosi, for sure. But the problem at the different elements of this party, Jeremy Corbyn really representing the kind of left of the British equivalent of the Democratic Party, but with Ilhan Omar, with Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, Rashida Tlaib, this idea of somehow there is the conspiracy behind circles, that whether there is disagreement with Israeli policy or the idea of Israeli money or the idea of plotting, those lines get blurred. And I think that perception factor, regardless of the reality, is why it is so important with the historical examples of anti-Semitism we have seen, whether it be pogroms, the Holocaust, or violent criminality, that the first basic point you take is no equivocation, unequivocal, keep it simple, stupid. And this wasn't simple as much as it spoke to other moral concerns, and that is a problem, I think.
Mo, and what was interesting on the presidential front, you had three 2020 Democrats out on the trail defending Ilhan Omar, Senator Kamala Harris, Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, a sticky thicket on the campaign trail.
Yeah, I think, again, to be able to say, and there were a couple of them that I thought used some curious language, trying to conflate criticism of Israel with anti-Semitism, because again, I think those are two very separate issues. I mean,
sure.
The Prime Minister of Israel was just indicted, right? I mean, Israel, you can criticize the government without criticizing the Jewish people. And I think it is important to make that distinction, and I think folks need to do a better job of that. But let's not make this a problem of the left. I mean, you had white supremacists marching in Charlottesville screaming, Jews will not replace us.
No one and on we the pointed left that out last night,
right?
On the panel.
No one on the left defended that. In fact, the only people who even came close to that were decidedly not on the left. And so I think anti-Semitism is a huge problem.
Right, but let me just
globally.
Say this, that, you know, how the Republicans handled Steve King, critics would say they didn't do it fast enough. They didn't do it enough.
About a decade
right.
late.
No, I'm saying. But they did do something. They took him off the committees. They rebuked him. They look at this and say, why isn't it that way for Omar?
It took about... I'm sorry.
And that's what I think is interesting. This is part of a pattern that we've seen in recent weeks. You had the situation in Virginia where top government officials were supporting infanticide, accused of sexual assault, racism, and there were some initial inklings that there was going to be some accountability there, but then everybody circled the wagons and let that all go away.
Anyone circled the wagons?
Well, the top three Democratic officials in Virginia are still in office.
There's no recourse to remove them from office.
Well,
every Democratic office holder in Virginia has called on them to step down.
They've been very silent. It's just like what happened with this situation. At first, you heard people condemning the anti-Semitism, and then they all backed away. And so you don't want that to become the pattern for the Democratic Party, that they're tolerating these types of things that would have previously been considered beyond the pale.
Yeah,
I'll give you the last word.
I don't see anyone tolerating anti-Semitism. I don't see anybody tolerating the instances in Virginia. Democrats have done a very good job of policing their own on these issues, and I think the fact that they are ought to be something that Republicans can learn from moving forward as they struggle with a lot of these same issues themselves.
Clearly, they wanted to be on something else this week.
Everyone did, yeah.
Okay, we're looking live at the courthouse in Alexandria, Virginia. We still don't have an answer on this sentencing. We don't have a time. We don't know what the judge is doing, actually. He's in recess. Paul Manafort has spoken to the judge there. We're waiting. We're waiting with you. We will talk about 2020 if we don't have a decision. If not, we'll talk about this after the break.
If the Democrats decide in their wisdom to nominate a far-left person, Donald Trump will get reelected.
I don't embrace socialism. I think the genius of America in many ways is that we've embraced capitalism and all of its power to innovate and create jobs.
We will have a Medicare for all single-payer system. We are going to make public colleges and universities tuition-free.
Bernie Sanders continuing his tour, heading to Iowa tonight. Peter Ducey, you saw him there earlier. As you look at the 2020 Democratic hopefuls, they are expanding. There are more and more of them. The exploratory are likely in. The possibles are possible, and Joe Biden, the biggest of those. But one key member saying he's not running in the possible category, and that is Sherrod Brown, the senator from Ohio. Back with the panel. Tom, as you look at this field, really the Biden is the biggest question mark.
Biden is the biggest question mark, and as much as we were saying in the first panel about the differences between Nancy Pelosi and the establishment and the rising populist force of the far left, we see this with the Democratic primaries, where Joe Biden really, from my point of view, seems to be the only sort of traditionalist Democrat, at least in terms of what these candidates are saying now. And so the question for the party then becomes, whether Biden wins or not, can there be a candidate who can bring together these very disparate strands, talking about those fundamentals that Democrats seem to expect now in the populist left of Medicare for all, etc., but in a way that doesn't allow President Trump to say, this is what it will mean for your taxes.
Yeah, I knew your Times is out, we're saying 95% in, but the 5% is a big hurdle, so maybe the 5% is a little bit more than 5%. Here's Joe Biden and Eric Trump responding.
They, the most important people in my life, want me to run.
If you want to run Biden against my father, I think it's going to be an easy victory, because all you need to do is line up stats, not sound bites, but quantifiable
Biden
stats,
numbers.
And he beats him all day long.
As you look at the Real Clear Politics standings right now, this is largely about name recognition, but Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders take, almost 50% of this at this point.
Yeah, Joe Biden had that great everyman appeal that worked well for him throughout his political career. It's why he could win states like Pennsylvania and Michigan. It's also, though, why it was so surprising to see him get bullied last week by an actor who said that he was wrong for not saying that Mike Pence was evil. And he agreed that he was wrong for not saying that, which is sort of exactly the opposite of what he should be doing at this time. But Bernie Sanders does also have that. And, we see that Bernie Sanders has that excitement. He has this authenticity about him. He might have embraced a lot of questionable ideas in his history, including support for the Soviet Union in the 1980s, but he's very consistent about it, and he really is who he presents as.
Is there a fear in the Democrat Party, Mo, about Bernie Sanders being this popular, about raising this much money, about getting these big crowds? Is there somehow an inherent threat for the party that Sanders is that popular?
Yeah, I wouldn't characterize anything as fear at this point. It's a large field, and it makes sense that the one guy who has done this before.
Way into the primaries.
Right, exactly. He's the only announced candidate who has run for president before. So he's going to have a high name ID. He's going to pull in the big crowds. But he's not a runaway front runner at this point. And so I think there's plenty of time for the other candidates to make their case. I do agree with Molly that both Bernie and Biden have that authenticity about them, as well as that everyman appeal. They both come across as, I think the fundamental question that most voters ask themselves is, does this person get me and will they get my back? And both Bernie and Biden, in very different ways, answer that question in a way that comes across as very authentic. No one else has really known yet. And so the campaign is going to be their opportunity, their interview, to answer those two questions. So I think it's anybody's game at this point.
Over under on the number of candidates?
I think we're looking at about 15.
I'll take 20.
20.
22. When we come back, could it be the Manafort sentencing? This is a Fox News alert. We just received word at the end of this show that Paul Manafort has been sentenced by the judge for bank fraud and other charges for roughly 4 years in prison. He was facing 19 and a half to 24. 4 years in prison. We expect to hear the details of this, what the judge said, just coming down the second we went back from break. Paul Manafort, the former Trump campaign chairman, and obviously he's facing other charges. Next week gets the sentencing on other charges, but this has nothing to do with Russia or collusion or anything to deal with the Trump campaign, but it deals with bank fraud and the handling of some of his business in the past. Quickly, Molly, surprised by that?
No, but it is, the judge did make a point of saying that it had nothing to do with Russia. 4 years sounds like a much more reasonable sentence than the 20 years that he was facing.
Again, Martha McCallum will have more on this breaking story. That's it for this special report. Of course, breaking at the end, fair, balanced, and unafraid. The story hosted by Martha.